It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. Woo, and I'm feeling good.
This is a BIPOC Repertory Theater Company.
We add the singing and the piano playing of Miss Nina Simon. Nina Simon.
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how.
BIPOC. Black, Indigenous, person of color.
It's a new dawn, it's a new day,
and I'm feeling
it's a new life for me. Yeah, it's a new dawn, it's a new day for me. Ooh.
Space, embodied presence, listening. Love and possibility, agency, angry compassion, responsibility, presence and action, sight. My voice, uncenteredness, reflections, validation and voice. Our voices, hope, advocacy, the silenced stories of Black people taking space. I matter. My voice and my body matters.
And I'm feeling
it's a new life for me.
Voice. Voice. Voice.
Good evening, everybody. Or afternoon or morning, wherever your feet touch the ground. My name is Nisha Sachnani, and I'm the director of the program in drama therapy at NYU. And I want to begin with an acknowledgement that my feet touch the ground on Quinnipiac soil tonight. Thank you so much for joining us for Free Play by Idris Goodwin, the first production of the CollideOscope Repertory Theater, a theater with a mission to advance racial justice and healing through performance. Indeed, we see justice, healing, and artistry as intertwined. The invisible legacy of colonialism and slavery is visible in our bodies, in how we relate to ourselves and each other, and it's made manifest in performance, in a ritual that allows us to be together, to gather and attend to these stories and to each other in this space. Please join us in conversation after the performance with artistic director Adam Stevens. Thank you so much for being here. Enjoy.
Timothy Lohman.
Officer Timothy Lohman.
Frank Garnback and Tim Lohman refused to talk to investigators.
Killed 12-year-old Tamir Rice has...
Lohman told a fellow cop, quote,
"Summertime.
He, Tamir, gave me no choice. He reached for the gun and there was nothing I could do." The report says Lohman told another officer that, quote, "they arrived on scene, was yelling commands at the kid, they stopped the car, the kid went for the firearm and tried to pull it out." Lohman's account differs than those from witnesses who say they did not hear officers issue any warnings to the boy. We all know by now Tamir was playing with a toy gun. Toy gun, toy gun, toy gun, toy gun.
Are you listening?
Uh-huh.
You just press this button and it takes off. Like, whoosh. Just by pressing a button. Cindy has the best toys.
Oh, that's great, Sam.
Yeah, so awesome. So awesome. And that's not all. Nope, that's not all.
No?
Mm-mm. They have a dog and a cat and an iguana. Can you believe that?
And an iguana?
Mm-hmm. Yup, his name is Ivan. Mm. Ivan Iguana. And guess what the cat's name is?
Oh. Yeah, that's so nice.
Are you listening?
Yes, I am.
I asked if you can guess the cat's name, and you said, that's real nice.
I misunderstood you. I'm listening. Okay, look, see? I put my phone down.
Okay. The cat's name. Yes.
What's the cat's name?
Try and guess.
Oh, I don't know. Furball.
No.
Well?
Obama.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Huh. That's so cute.
Yeah, because he's half black and half white.
I'm sorry, what?
Oh, some of the cat's fur is black and some of it is...
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I get it.
It's so much fun at Cindy's house.
How are Cindy's parents towards you?
Well, what do you mean?
Like, how do they treat you?
What do you mean?
Like, are they nice to you?
Of course they're nice to me.
But do they ever say anything that makes you feel, like, uncomfortable?
No. Cindy's my friend.
Because you can tell me if they do. As a matter of fact, I need you to tell me if they do.
It's okay. We just have fun. Oh, hey, you know what else?
What else?
We had a huge water fight.
Oh, yeah.
It was so cool. Cindy's mom filled this bucket with like water balloons and buckets and, ooh, you know what else?
What else? What else?
Well, nothing.
Now you got me all curious. Tell me.
Well, nothing.
Was it water guns? Was it water guns, Sam? Hey, it's okay. I'm not mad.
You're not?
No, I understand. You were having fun.
It was so much fun.
And when you're at someone else's house, that's fine.
It was so much fun. Cindy has this one that goes so far.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm. Like, so far.
But Cindy knows that when she comes here, we don't do that, right?
Well, yeah, I told her that.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm. I told her and her mom and her dad.
What'd they say?
Nothing.
Nothing?
No. They didn't say anything. They just went like this.
Well, what did you say?
Well, I said that we can't play water guns at my house.
And did you say why?
No.
Well, Sam, you have to say why.
But I don't know why.
Of course you know why.
But I don't know why.
Sam, come on. We've talked about this.
But I don't understand. A water gun is plastic, and it's colorful, and it's for water, and it's not real.
But it's a gun.
For water. There are tons of guns that, like, light up and make noise. Guns like space alien guns.
You remember when it was our days to take snack for the whole class? We made sure to find something that everyone could eat, right?
Yes. Okay.
Why did we do that?
Well, because some kids can't have dairy or gluten or meat.
We did that to be considerate of other people's allergies. Do you know what happens when people's allergies act up?
They don't feel good.
Right. They don't feel good. They get sick. Well, guns make me feel a little sick. Even if it's a toy gun. If it has a barrel and a trigger, I have a reaction.
What kind?
Okay. You know how some nights you have bad dreams?
Yes.
Well, I have them sometimes, in the daytime, even when I'm awake, and I think of you with guns, even toys, I have quick bad dreams in my head.
What kind?
Something happens when toys are in the hands of children, especially little brown-skinned children like you.
What happens to them?
Sometimes grown-ups can't tell the difference between something being a toy and it being real, even if you're playing. Not everybody's in on the game.
Oh. Well, I have an idea.
What's your idea?
Well, to let everyone know that we're just playing, we can sing a song.
What kind of song?
The water gun song.
Well, how does the water gun song go?
Well, okay. Okay. Water gun, water gun. It's so fun. It's so fun. Sing it with me. Sing it with me. Come on. Water gun, water gun.
Water gun, water gun.
It's so fun. It's so fun.
It's so fun. It's so fun.
It's just a game. It's not real.
It's just a game. It's not real.
It's just pretend. It's not real.
It's just pretend. It's not real.
Yeah. What about that? Well, maybe that would help.
Oh, maybe. Either way, I like it.
Well, when you get the bad dreams, you can sing that song.
Okay.
Oh, you know what else?
Hey, you know Obama, the person, not the cat, it's more than his colors, right?
Of course.
Okay, just making sure.
What about nunchucks? Can I have nunchucks in the house?
Okay. We'll talk about it.
Hey! Ooh, hey, you know what else?
Truthfully, I didn't know what Juneteenth was.
I had no clue before.
I've seen it on my calendar.
As to Juneteenth, there were a lot of people who didn't know what Juneteenth was.
He's going down to Texas on Juneteenth, right? The first major massacre, literally speaking, of the Black Wall Street, right?
Google searches prove that, and you can see I looked at the chart on Google searches on Juneteenth, and this year they went like this, and that's thanks to President Trump.
You may remember that President Trump had to move his big rally in Tulsa, Oklahoma, because it was originally scheduled on the same day as Juneteenth. Now, that was particularly awkward because Tulsa is the site of an infamous 1921 massacre of black people. But in a new interview with the Wall Street Journal, Trump says that he had no idea Juneteenth was even a thing, and that he polled many people around him, and none of them had heard of Juneteenth either. Now, I don't know why that's surprising. Of course, nobody around Trump had heard of Juneteenth. Look at the people he has around him. Look at them. Mike Pence doesn't even know what a cayenne pepper is. You think he's gonna know about black history? But to be fair, Trump is hardly alone. There are many Americans who don't know what Juneteenth is.
That super world of my own. Nobody but you and me. We've got it together, baby.
What rhymes with Juneteenth?
Oh, that's a hard one. I'm not sure. Juneteenth. Juneteenth. Juneteenth.
I've been sitting here blank for 10 minutes.
What are you doing?
Well, it's for school. We're supposed to present our favorite holiday.
I thought your favorite was Halloween.
It is Halloween.
So why are you asking me how to rhyme Juneteenth?
Because this year for Halloween, I'm going as one of the liberation soldiers in 1865 who went all the way down to Galveston, Texas to deliver the message that the enslaved people were free. Did you know it took 2 years after the Emancipation Proclamation?
Wow.
I love soldiers, but I thought, wouldn't it be cool to be one of those soldiers who went all the way down to Galveston, Texas to deliver the good news to hundreds of enslaved people?
So your report is not on Halloween?
Well, the report is, but the rap, it'll be about Juneteenth.
Your report is on Halloween and your rap is on Juneteenth.
Exactly. Every kid knows Halloween, but not everyone knows Juneteenth. So putting a rap makes sense, right?
Yes, it does.
Okay. I just need to think of a rhyme. Yeah.
Maybe you break it in half and rhyme June
and then teens. So moon and
moon thief?
Juneteenth moon thief.
What does liberating enslaved people have to do with stealing the moon?
Good question. What if you didn't rhyme Juneteenth, but rhyme the words around them?
I thought of that, but if I can think of a good rhyme for Juneteenth, more people remember it. I mean, that's what rhymes are for.
True.
Juneteenth.
Let me check out the rhyming website.
There's a rhyming website?
Yep. Okay. Juneteenth.
But isn't it cheating to use a rhyming website?
No more or less than using a dictionary. Nope. Nothing rhymes with Juneteenth. Don't get frustrated. We'll figure it out. You know what?
What?
I rapped a little in middle school.
Really?
Well, once, some friends and I went as the hip-hop group Arrested Development for Halloween.
Who?
Doesn't matter. We learned one of their songs and performed it for the Halloween school assembly.
You did?
Your grandma has a video of it somewhere. I was Speech, the lead rapper. And I really had to study his lyrics. Woo. But the thing I noticed is he never really rhymes the entire word. Tennessee. He just rhymes B and C. For some strange reason it had to be, he guided me to Tennessee. So don't get caught up trying to find the perfect rhyme. There's lots of ways to make it work.
But how?
You tell me. What's Juneteenth?
A celebration
of
being free.
Free rhymes with a lot, doesn't it?
Yes. It does. It does so many things. Here, let me change it.
Ready to check it out?
Okay, so pretend I'm in my liberation soldier uniform.
Oh my gosh, you look amazing.
Thank you. Me. We all know the story. Divided states, civil wars, bullets and hate. Brother versus brother, slave versus master, a bloody chapter of American disaster. Lincoln had a plan to free every man, woman, and girl enslaved in the land. The South said, wait, that's not your call. The war wasn't over, so the news got stalled. 2 years after emancipation, black people were enslaved. I said black and not African-American because African-American has so many syllables.
No problem. Keep going.
Okay, let me start back a bit. The South said, wait, that's not your call. The war wasn't over, so the news got stalled. 2 years after emancipation, black people were enslaved across the nation. They didn't know the South to lose. Would soon they get the freedom news? Until then, they stayed in danger, waiting on the troops of General Danger. June 19th, that's the date. Jubilee, Jubilee, let's celebrate. And word is spread across the South, and that's what Juneteenth is about. So from Texas to Tennessee, hip hop hooray, now we're free. June is here, We are free, celebrate this day for eternity. We are free, we are free! Juneteenth is here, it's Jubilee! When I say June, you say teeth, June.
Teeth,
June.
Teeth.
And one more thing I must say, Juneteenth is my real favorite holiday. I just made up that last part of my head just now.
How subversive.
What's subversive mean?
It means that you are the best kind of liberation soldier. And for that... you get ice cream.
Tennessee.
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 Lord, I've really been real stressed. Down and out, losing grass. Although I am black and grass, problems got me pessimistic.
You know, I usually give the history lessons around here, but go ahead, Alo Black. You know, I'll just sit here.
Slave, yes, I'm only a slave. They'll place my body in an unmarked grave. In these Confederate days, it's kinda hard to lift every voice singing while worrying about how low the sweet chariots are swinging. I could swing from a tree, but hey, oh, I hope and pray they don't kill me today. I am still just a slave.
If the Emancipation Proclamation was passed in 1863, why weren't you free until 1865?
Well, it took 2 years for the Civil War to end.
Oh, so you were free when the war ended?
Nah, not for 2 more months because Texas landowners wanted another harvest.
That's not cool.
None of it was cool. But an army ship arrived on June 19, 1865 and announced we were free. That's why we celebrate Juneteenth.
I am a slave and the home of the brave. A product of the triangular trade. Please pardon my ways if I'm nervous or the slightest bit skittish. In the presence of the Portuguese, Spanish, Dutch, or British, they kept me in colonial chains. Tell me how to persuade them to chill or to save me, and still I'm a slave.
Believe what?
I was getting a drink of water, and I heard the higher-ups talking.
They didn't catch you listening to them, did they?
No.
Like eavesdroppers.
I know that's right.
Listen.
Seriously, this one time, there was and I was going...
So it turns out, we are free!
What?
Free?
Seriously, free!
That ain't even funny.
It's no joke. I heard him saying it. And it turns out we have been free for a while now and no one told us.
How long of a while?
Days? Month?
Years!
How is that?
Years? What?
Supposed to be someone coming down to tell us. But then he got lost? Or maybe died in some quicksand or something.
They just sent one person to tell us.
Well, now there's a bunch of troops coming.
How many troops?
How should I know? All I know is that we are free, which means we don't have to do this anymore.
This? What is this?
I'm all this.
So we are free.
Yes.
So I could just walk off right now.
Right now.
And nobody would come after me?
Why would they? You're as free as they are.
Have you talked to the higher-ups about this?
They were talking, trying to figure out how to tell everyone.
How to tell us? What's so hard about just telling us?
Well, I think they're worried that some folks, you know, the lower than them, but higher than us folks, will be scared because this has been the arrangement for so long. And you know, people don't like change.
Amen to that.
Change and mosquitoes.
So, when they tell us, look surprised, because I probably wasn't supposed to say anything.
But if we've been free a while, what's it matter?
What do you mean?
That's a good point. If we've actually been free this whole time, then we can just go right now.
No! Well, they probably wouldn't appreciate that. As far as they know, we still think we aren't free. So if we started walking around like we were free, they'd think, hey,
what's the big idea?
But you said it. We are free.
You did say that.
Yes. As soon as the higher ups tell us.
That don't make no sense. So.
Well, none of this makes sense.
If we've been free even longer than you heard them say we've been free, what if we are the only gaggle of fools thinking they aren't free, and the whole time everybody else been sipping lemonade and going about their day jolly as a rabbit in May?
I'm pretty sure that has not been the case.
Imagine.
So when they tell us, what are we supposed to do?
Anything we want. Me, I'm gonna get my own land and work it.
Work some land? That's what you do now.
How are you even gonna get some land?
You know, there's gotta be some land somewhere nobody's using. What about you?
Not sure, just be free, I guess. Walk around with my free self, thinking free thoughts.
Hey. Do you think people will change how they treat us now that we are free? What? We free now.
Well, not yet, according to you.
Well, soon they're gonna come down and read. I think they called it a charter or something.
Sometimes paper ain't nothing but dead tree.
Who did you hear that from?
A tree.
You all don't seem excited. I don't understand.
Because for us, what does free even mean? Free to do what? What good is it to be free if you don't have anything? The higher-ups became higher-ups because their daddies were higher-up. My mother wasn't free, and her father wasn't free, and his father wasn't free. They didn't pass down anything to me but bad memories.
That's a good point.
Get land, grow crops, and sell them to who? You think the people who used to be in charge will do business with someone 5 minutes ago they thought was no different than the cow?
You do sound like a cow when you snore.
That's not funny.
Think of you more than bad memories. You're smart and you're strong, and that's all you need to build anything. Some wits and some muscle.
That's a good point.
Hey, be quiet. Just a minute ago, you were agreeing with me.
Okay. Here they come. Here they come.
How should we act?
What is natural for free people who thought they wasn't? Oh. Here they come.
Quiet, y'all. Come on.
After this, it'll all be over.
Something tells me this will not be over soon.
Maybe not soon, but it will be over.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring.
I understand where the pain comes from.
Ring with the harmonies.
But you have to be aware that that's not the whole story.
Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies.
With what we have going on here, it's our heritage, it's who we are.
Let it resound.
It's just such a personal symbol, like here in the South, and it means so much to so many people. Like, it's just about pride and where you come from and being proud to show who you are.
Loud as the rolling sea. Faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song.
present has.
Fall semester, late August. Finally in the flesh.
No.
So you see your Facebook picture and now here you are.
So good to finally meet you.
Yes. Are you ready for this?
Can't wait.
Okay, Rumi. First things first. You might not take this side. It just felt right to me.
All yours.
We can always switch after Christmas break. Oh, I mean, winter recess.
You can say Christmas break here.
You got any more stuff I can help?
Oh, nah. I thought I'd start, like, going to be hitting my mama for them care packages on the regular.
My mom sent me with everything.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I got jars of peaches. I got peanut brittle. I got moon pies.
Lord, no. Whew. Keep all that away from me.
Oh, you mean these?
Oh, yes. I mean those.
You don't want these.
Oh, Sunny.
This right here.
So, you going to the mixer?
Yeah, you.
I don't know.
Oh, come on. You gotta come. I won't know anybody there.
But won't you meet people? Isn't that the point? I guess your mom really did pack everything for you.
Oh, she just wants to make sure I don't forget. She says, now don't you get lost out there. She's got a lot of pride.
A lot of pride.
That's where I come from, you know? It's okay, right? I mean, I know it's a little Southern girl rebel flag, but I don't know. You seem like a rebel to me.
Your side of the room.
You mind giving me a hand? Actually, I think. Hey, I saw that they have soft serve in the cafeteria. Do you want to come down with me?
I got a lot of stuff here.
Okay, well, you have my number, so text me if you change your mind and want to meet up.
Yeah, I'll do that.
All right.
Fall semester. November. That's mine.
It was under my bed.
But it's mine.
Well, I thought it was something of mine.
Well, it's not, so... You didn't read it, did you? You shouldn't have read this. Once you saw that it wasn't something of yours, you shouldn't have read it.
Well, I did. So?
She says we have to write about what we're feeling and what's on our mind, and we gotta be honest.
So this is what you really think?
You really shouldn't have read it.
It's so secretive, yet you read it to your entire class and professor?
But come on, Sydney, didn't you ever think for a second, maybe, just maybe, I might be uncomfortable by this?
But I don't mean it like that, like in a...
It's your side of the room. You have a right to whatever you want on your wall.
You said it assaults you. This cross burning its Confederate history into my nightmares. Deja, you don't think I'm like one of those dumb redneck assholes that you
read? Never called you a dumb redneck. You have the poem in your hands. I never said anything about you.
The poem is called To My Roommate.
It wasn't to you, it was a free right. And in a free write, you're supposed to just let the thoughts fall out of your brain. She says don't censor, and I didn't.
I just didn't realize that. When I put it up, I didn't even think of it as something that could be a problem for you.
Of course you didn't.
I don't mean it like that. It represents, you know, my home, my culture, the good things, though. I don't mean it like...
It's whatever, okay? Your side of the room.
Well, I don't want you to be uncomfortable.
I said it's whatever.
Okay, all right.
All right?
All right. Last one.
It's all good. You have it.
Semester, December. Is that?
Yeah. My roommate is from the South and she has a lot of pride.
Was this up when you moved in?
She actually asked me to help her put it up.
Oh, really?
Yep.
No.
Yep. First day, she pulled it out of her bag and hung it up.
Ironically?
Her mother gave it to her so she wouldn't forget, you know, where she came from.
So it doesn't bother you? Okay.
Look, I know how it looks.
Yeah, it looks kind of racist.
Yeah.
Maybe, you know, like, her mom wanted to remind her where she came from. Didn't want her getting lost out here with all these weirdos and godless heathens. Now,
honey... When you get out there, don't you grow fraternizing with all them homos and Arabs.
Stop.
You know, you can bring this up to the school, you know. Tell me you want a different roommate. I'm for real.
I thought of that at first, but...
But...
It's not... This is going to sound like I'm trying to make a pun, but... It's not so black and white. I see one thing and she sees something else. It's not clear cut. I see slavery, obviously, but she sees like her mama and just like being country and Southern. You know, you see this flag on like belt buckles and country albums and what was that TV show with the car?
I don't know.
My grandpa was always watching it. Something with a car.
I don't know.
She just sees like country pride in a real generic way. Just means I'm from the South.
Where they used to enslave African Americans.
You are too much.
Tell me I'm wrong.
I just got here, you know. It's my first year of college. I worked my ass off. It's already hard enough just trying to... can't I just go to my classes and parties? Do I have to be starting this whole thing just because I see something different on her side of the room? I don't like it. I don't, but I don't like a lot of things I see and hear from white folks.
No. I mean, I feel you, but...
But you always with that. Why do you even care? You ain't black.
Well, Deja, for starters, I hate slavery.
You sure it's not just some prejudice against Southerners based on a bunch of stereotypes? You assume they're all racist and want slavery back.
No. But...
A flag is just colors and fabric. The meaning changes depending on like who's holding it and who's looking at it. I just gotta try and get through this first year. And then I can try and get reassigned for some other arbitrary ass reason. But no, I'm sorry. I'm not gonna be the black girl who started some shit, the angry black girl who started some shit over a flag. Especially when the girl who put the flag up is this sweet, bubbly girl just trying to stay connected to home. It's gonna start a whole thing. People gonna be all over Facebook and Yik Yak and putting my picture all over the internet, giving their opinions. No.
Wow. You've given this a lot of thought.
The brochure ain't say nothing about this.
The Boys of Hazzard.
What?
The show that you were...
No. It was Hazzard. Duke's a Hazzard.
yup.
Jesus, Sydney.
I'm so sorry, Deja. I didn't know you were studying. Who's this, Dej?
I'm Harry.
I'm so sorry.
Sydney, what you been drinking?
Just iced tea.
Just iced tea.
It's from just up the way, this wonderful place they call Long Island.
Oh, my God. Sorry, Harry. I might have to...
It's all right.
No.
Hey, I can Sydney, help if...
Sydney, why don't you just lay down?
I just came here for...
Come on, Sydney. You should really lay down.
Come here for...
You might want to get a bucket.
What do you say, Herman?
Harry.
What do you say?
I don't... What did I say?
Something about a bucket?
Yeah, you just... You look pretty messed up.
Maybe you don't know me, but Sydney Blanchard does not puke.
Uh-huh.
Oh, God.
Okay, Deja, I'll call you.
Oh, hey, no. Look, I didn't mean to interrupt. Look, I want you to come here, damn it. There. Lovely. Oh, I remember what I came here for. Bye, y'all.
Bye.
Harry.
What the hell accent was that supposed to be?
Oh, I wasn't doing an accent.
No, because it sounded like you were trying to parrot me.
He wasn't, Sid.
I know what a fake southern accent sounds like, see, because I come from Georgia, and when we say bye, we say it like how I just said it, bye. But you sounded like you were from Texas or something, and you said bye. You see the difference?
Thank you.
Okay, Sydney. Bye, girl.
Oh, wait. I'm so sorry. Y'all want some of these peaches?
No.
No, Sydney.
Suit yourself. Little taste of home right there.
Yup, you got your home all over this place with your peaches and your flag.
Stop it!
What's that, Harry?
Now she remembers my name.
We're gonna go to you. Let's just all get out of the room.
No, no. I think I want to stay here with you and Harry in my room.
With your flag.
Yeah, and your flag.
This is a shirt.
But it's a flag, and you're walking it around everywhere on your shirt. California Bear Revolt all up in everybody's face. At least mine is here in my space, my private space.
Calm down.
I don't like this guy, Deja. This guy's a, he's a.
Sid.
You can do better than this, idiot. Isn't that right, idiot?
Hey, don't call me an idiot, you drunk.
Stop it. Both of you, stop it.
Calling me an idiot. Hey, at least I ain't racist.
You don't even know me. You don't even know me.
Hey, I know what this is.
Cindy, maybe you just want to calm down.
Give me that, Deja. You're the first one who started this crap.
Oh, wait. Don't yell at her. You're the one who's being so insensitive at bringing this flag.
Turning everyone against me. Making me out to be some kind of racist. I am not. My best friend in high school was black.
You are a racist.
My track coach was black.
You have a racist mentality.
A racist?
That's what you have.
You're the one who's talking about race. Oh, I am not a racist.
Spring semester, early January.
Over the break, the winter recess, my whole family, cousins, aunties, we all meet up in Stone Mountain Park, just outside of Atlanta. We have this tradition, you know, day after Christmas, go there, have a picnic. It's real nice. Trees, lots of land, and of course, a big old plantation house. And a museum about the plantation house where they tell you these stories about the old times and how things used to be. And then there's Stone Mountain. There's an actual stone mountain right there staring down at you. And chiseled into the side are all these like Civil War guys like Jefferson and Stonewall and Robert E. We grow up hearing about these guys like they're saints our whole lives. And really, my family is not black. Anyway, so we're there that day and there's this other family there. Well, really there's a lot of other families there that day, but there's this one that I keep on overhearing. Two guys, really. And they say that it was right there on Stone Mountain that the Klan, they jump-started the Klan there. like the Second Coming. Well, they don't share that fact with you at the old plantation museum. Well, these two guys, they kept talking about action and Dylan Roof.
The South Carolina shooter?
They were saying how they thought he was just some mixed up kid and that they didn't agree with murder, but didn't he have some balls and at least he wasn't afraid to take some action?
Oh my God.
Yeah, and I wanted to walk over to them and say a million things, but look, Deja, I'm not gonna lie to you like a lot of these so-called liberal kids here do. I've heard shit like it before. But what really, really hit me was that these two guys were complaining about how after Roof killed those people, they took down the flag.
Your flag.
Yes, this flag. They took it down in South Carolina. And these two guys kept saying, they better not try to do that here in Georgia. That big-eared son of a bitch Obama better not try to take my flag. And it kept going on and on. And I swear, Deja, I thought of you and that night with that Harry.
He's not so bad.
Whatever, I know you guys are booed up now. But I thought about you and that poem you wrote. How you wrote, "Its arms blocking off history from evolving past its scars." My mama gave this to me so that I wouldn't forget her and how she raised me. But now when I see it, all I see are those two guys talking about Dylan Roof and action and God, Deja, it's time. It's gotta come down.
Your flag right there.
Yes.
Good.
But, can you help me?
How?
Help me take it down.
Help you take it down or take it down for you?
No, you don't want this here. Every day you gotta be thinking, oh, I just wanna yank that thing.
Sydney.
And I get it now.
Sydney.
Do it. Take it down. It's okay with me.
But it's not okay with me.
But I...
Wait. Just listen. I don't want to take your flag down for you. See, if I take the flag down, then the story is it came down because you have a black roommate. Because your black roommate was uncomfortable, but it should make you uncomfortable. It should make anybody uncomfortable. I want you to want to take your flag down. I want those guys in Stone Mountain Park to want to take it down. I want...
Okay.
It has to be you.
Why can't I bring myself to move? Why does it hurt when I try?
It's like you told me. It's where you come from. It's pride.
Who's probably gonna sin again? Lord, forgive me. Lord, forgive me. Things I don't understand. Sometimes I need to be alone. Bitch, don't kill my vibe. Bitch, don't kill my vibe.
I can feel your energy from two planets away. I got my drink, I got my music, I will share it. But today I'm living. Bitch, don't kill my vibe. Bitch, don't kill my vibe. Bitch, don't kill my vibe.
Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us today. I know that many in Louisville and across the Commonwealth and country have been anxiously awaiting the completion of our investigation into the death of Miss Breonna Taylor.
So we are an hour and 12 minutes past curfew, and right now the protesters rule the streets. The National Guard, nowhere to be seen. The state police, nowhere to be seen. The local police, nowhere to be seen. The sheriff's department, nowhere to be seen. The protesters are the ones that feel like these streets are their streets, which you will hear people chant.
Black lives matter! Black lives matter! Black lives matter! Black lives matter!
It's a weekend.
Well, tonight, Louisville is increasingly on edge. Police in riot gear making arrests after the long-awaited announcement. No officers charged for causing Breonna Taylor's death.
Is this what you expected?
Love you too.
Yeah, I mean, I did, but I had a little hope, just a little bit.
Prologue.
We lived next door to each other as kids.
Now the same city.
We were never really that close during any of it, but we knew each other.
I'd see him here and there.
We were aware of one another.
We kept our space, not consciously. We just ran in different spaces.
But we were always aware. Social war.
Another body, another name, another image has circulated. The latest body name, the newest image to haunt.
It's shameful.
I posted, this is no time for apathy.
I liked it.
The fight for equality continues on.
Liked it.
And then I typed a hashtag in three words, words I thought anyone could get behind.
I didn't quite like that. So I responded with a hashtag in three words, nothing offensive, words I thought anyone could get behind.
I didn't quite like that, so I deleted it.
She deleted my post, totally hypocritical.
My wall, my space, and yeah, I did edit it. This is the one space where I can build the world that I'd like to inhabit.
I respond to her posts a lot. We share the same algorithm, politically.
My response was to delete it.
I responded, because erasure is never okay.
My response...
This is not a race issue, not really. This is about abuse of power.
My response was to delete it.
I responded, this is about equality, the shared human experience, no time for stark divisions along racial lines. This is a time to recognize our shared humanity.
Are you crazy?
She deleted my response. I messaged her.
He messaged me.
We haven't seen each other for a while or spoken. The last time was at a concert. The MC performed this, she was a little mad at me because the MC performed this song with the N-word in the chorus and she saw me singing along. She never said anything, but after the show, she was cold to me.
He messaged me.
Hey, Kim, I know it's been a while.
He felt that we needed to talk, needed to clear the air.
Can we sit down for a coffee sometime?
I want to ask you what you meant, but I'm finding it hard to ask you. So what I'd rather do is just tell you what I think about what I thought you meant.
Oh, I can explain what I meant.
Well, I'm sure you can, but can you explain what I read and how I took it to mean?
I just meant that we are all comprised of matter. It matter being that essential molecular element of which we're all built, you know, ordinary matter, like trees and water, solids and liquids.
Yeah, but sound, the voice, for example, was not always considered matter. You know, matter used to only encompass like a select set of solid objects.
But all along, it was always matter.
What happens to matter split? Does it explode and decimate millions of bodies of color? And whose hands split that matter? What we're talking about are black lives split, shaken, until they become bombs.
These lives, those lives, it's ridiculous. Look, we're here and we get to decide how this is gonna go. It doesn't have to, it shouldn't be. And we don't have to ascribe to an aside. There was that summer after our senior year of high school. We were both short on credits and all of our friends left town. We were stuck. We both ended up getting jobs at the library to make some extra cash. We got kind of close that summer. We talked about books, smoked joints on our lunch break. That was the summer I got into R&B, and I turned her onto some indie rock. I thought, man, what a cool chick. There was that night after our shift. We got those tall cans and and we decided to break into the school. We heard somebody coming and so we ducked into the only open room we could find, the chemistry room. It was dark in there and we were real quiet. We drank some more and we started to get close. I don't know, maybe it's because things were coming to an end. We got close to, but we didn't. She stopped suddenly and said she had to go home. We're on the same side, Kim.
Are we?
Yes, we want the same thing.
After another man is laying on the street, your immediate impulse was to correct me, talk semantics with me, to say, well, actually, Kim, I don't know what side that is. An aside. In particle physics, antimatter is material comprised of antiparticles, which have the same mass of particles of ordinary matter, but have an opposite charge.
I don't think anyone is less or more or special.
When we say Black Lives Matter, do you think that's us saying we're special? Look at us. We're getting shot.
No, but it is making your suffering out to be worse than others. Wait.
What?
Wait, that's not what I mean. Look, it's saying that your suffering is... I mean, what about Africa? All the Boko Haram stuff? Or women all over the world being assaulted?
I don't...
Or gays and lesbians? Hispanics being deported and shot at border crossings? Or hell, even poor white folk who live in black neighborhoods being bullied because of the crimes of others? And look, I am all for civil rights, but looting, property damage, and just rage?
No, it
doesn't work. It doesn't work. All lives, Kim. All lives. Let's pull the act from the context of the race and break it down to its root. Human wickedness.
And sometimes humans kill humans because of their race.
Wouldn't it be great if... I just wish we could move on. You know? Just be ourselves, be individuals. Just be our own shining stars. Our own perfect shining star. When we were kids, and we'd have a block party, all the kids would be out. We'd be getting our faces painted like Spider-Man, bike races. You know, we were all just kids in the neighborhood. When did we start to be...
You know, I was the only black kid at those block parties.
I didn't see it like that.
You didn't see I was black?
I didn't treat you different.
Yeah, but not everyone looks at it the same way.
An aside... She wasn't always like this.
An aside. I was silent. I used to be silent.
She used to be easygoing. You know what? A real cool chick.
I used to hold my breath. Breathe shallow. Up here in my chest.
We grew up the same way.
But the way we are perceived is different.
But that doesn't mean those perceptions are true.
The tree and the water are in the same forest, but they're not the same. Different masses, different volume, different uses. Are you willing to decrease your mass? Just say it. Black lives matter.
Do white lives not matter?
Nobody's saying what doesn't matter.
It's exclusionary.
It's contextual. It's in this climate. It's talking about the splitting of black atoms with no consequences.
An aside. I want to leave. I feel sick. I want to hug Kim and tell her I'm sorry. But also, if I'm being honest, tell her to get over it. Life is hard and there is no measuring stick for suffering. She can change this just by being herself, not this angry black woman.
An aside. I really want to let Cole off the hook. Drop this whole thing. You know, just tell him it's all good. But I have swallowed myself too many times to let white folks feel less uncomfortable.
I just want to fix it.
Cole wants to know how we fix this. He wants me to tell him I just woke up this way. I don't know how to dig into the hearts, rewire circuitry. Who does? All I'm trying to do is just keep it together.
I want to tell her I'm sorry.
I don't want your apologies. I just want it to stop.
To say it is to admit that my life, in someone's eyes, people living, people dead, has mattered more than other folks. And I don't think that it does. But someone at some point has believed that, and maybe my life has been better because of that.
That night in the chemistry room, when we got close, Cole and I, all those years ago, I was into it. I liked him. Until he put his hands in my hair. I thought about all those kids always asking to touch it. Well, can I touch it? Can I touch it? And how they would react when they did. And then he had his hands in my hair. And I wondered what he thought it felt like. You know, weird, funny, good. And then I thought about if he had been with any other black girls. And it just, it just became too much, you know? So I told him I had to go. I had to leave and I had to go home. And so I left. And that was the closest we ever got.
A week or two later, I sent Kim a message. I thanked her for the conversation and I said we should stay in touch, that I wanted to keep talking, not just about this, but about our lives in general, and nothing. That was that, I thought. But one morning, I I went on my timeline and I saw her picture and her name being shared by everyone. They called it a failure to comply, failure to be silent. And so she was made silent forever. She lives on now as a hashtag. Oh, but I can still hear her voice hanging in the particles. Does the spirit have mass? It must. I can feel the weight.
I am Chantal George. I am not Kim. I am very much alive. And I stand here for Breonna Taylor.
My name is Mary Elizabeth Morris. I am not Deja. I am very much here unapologetically speaking up and standing for Tony McDade.
I am Zara Warner. I am not three. I am here alive and defining my own freedom. And I stand here for Leilin Polanco.
My name is Jordan Daniel Stewart. I am not number two. I am yet alive and yet free. And I am standing in honor of 7-year-old Alana Washington.
My name is Kinasa Nazair. I am not number one. And although I am alive, my freedom is hanging on the balance. So I fight for Tatiana Jefferson.
I am Brandon Elam. I am not Pete. I am much here free and alive. And tonight I stand for Stephen Clark.
My name is Barbara Bethea, and I am not Jean. I am very much alive. I stand here for Amadou Diallo.
I am Michelle J. Buckle. I am not Jules. I believe in justice. And I stand here for Julian Donovan Wright.
I am Treasure Tanik. I am not Sam. And tonight I play and I stand with Demir Rice.
Designed to bounce with houses that arise. Designed to fill your mind now that you realize.
the prize arrives.
My name is Michelle J. Buckle, and I play the character Jules in the Water Gun song.
My name is Treasure, and I play Sam in the Water Gun song.
I'm Zara Warner. I play Three in Act Three. Say that five times fast.
Hi, my name is Kensa. I play the character One in the play Act Three.
My name is Mary Elizabeth Morris, and I played in the role of Deja in the play Black Flag.
I am Chantal George. I play the role of Kim in Hashtag Matters.
My name is Barbara Bethea, and I play the role of Jean in Juneteenth.
My name is Jordan Stewart in Act Free.
My name is Brandon Elam, and I play the role of Pete in Nothing Rhymes with Juneteenth.
And I'm Vicky Castain, and I play Sydney in Black Flag.
Hi, my name is Daniel Brown. I play the role of Harry in Black Flag.
My name's Jason Butler. I play the role of Cole in Hashtag Matters.
My name is Linda Soria, and I have the incredible honor of serving as the production stage manager.
My name is Idalmis Garcia, and I am the assistant director.
My name is Sonia Goel, and I am the assistant stage manager.
My name is Adam Stevens, and I am the artistic director for the CollideOscope Repertory Theater Company at NYU's Program in Drama Therapy. Good evening, good afternoon, good morning, wherever it is you are zooming in from, we welcome you.
Thank you, thank you. Hold your applause.
What is it you're taking away with you?
Just seeing all the moments captured of our rehearsals and, you know, our first reading together. Oh my gosh, it was beautiful.
It has been liberating. It has been life-giving.
This process for me has been about a centering, holding space.
Kind of helped ground me throughout the entire craziness that is 2020.
Very uplifting, very unapologetic, very open.
Community.
Even with all the technical difficulties of Zoom, I'm just extremely grateful that I was able to be a part of this, to share stories that don't often see the forefront.
Unapologetically uncensored and freed from a whitewash narrative.
My heart is glad, my soul rejoice. May CollideOscope reign and lift our voice.
Being afraid to be a Black woman, a person with a disability, a lover of life, and a healer.
Bob Marley once said, emancipate yourself from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds.
Ah, bueno.
You know, I don't think I've ever felt so me. I
really, really appreciate that all of me can come.
I love to be in a space that I don't have to explain myself, that I don't have to measure what I do, that I can just be me.
I feel like I'm there.
Insight. Fellowship.
If our profession, if our country, if our world is going to transform, then we need more of these dynamic spaces.
Because as artists and specifically creative arts therapists, we stand on the front line toward social change.
Although the world is a mess right now, and although we don't really know what to do, it's great to know that there's community gathering to at least figure it out.
Learning to be an effective ally.
Necessary conversations with ourselves about how we operate in the world, how we view ourselves, and our true purpose.
Marginalized individuals have lost control and power over their narrative, and they also lack representation in whatever story is being told about them.
Black, Indigenous, and persons of color to engage in therapeutic theater during these trying times is, as Audre Lorde would say, not self-indulgence, but self-preservation in an act of political warfare.
The conversations are happening, and I do believe this is drama therapy as social change.
Why I chose to take part of this production is for my daughter. As a new mom, I want to make sure that I continuously and actively raise her to be anti-racist.
It was a way that I could take action.
Each breath, each word, each line spoken is formed as a blessing and love token.
An unconditional, fierce, unapologetic love. Love. Love.
I'm just excited about it.
Thank you, everyone, for being here. Idris, thank you for your words that let us, you know, we did it here. And I love what Mambutu said in terms of this is on a world stage. It's on a world stage where we're centering those who've been marginalized, right? So thank you. Some of your impressions and reflections from the show.
It's got my whole body active, and it's got me thinking about the roles that I play, the different parts of this conversation that I find myself in.
I am stunned. My body has never gone through so many physical and emotional charges all at the same time. I've wanted to puke, I wanted to cry, my head was bursting and aching, I was shivering, I got mad, I laughed, I couldn't breathe, I managed to breathe, and thank you for those necessary feelings. Thank you for those necessary emotions. My heart is beating really fast.
And I was particularly moved when people were empathizing with Deja, were saying, I feel sorry for you, Deja, you know, and that's really gratifying as a writer, just because these are people, you know, they're fictional, but they're not fictional. You know, I write what I see, I write what I overhear, and I explore questions and the complexities. And so,
one line that is sticking with me, there's many, but I've swallowed myself so many times. And, you know, I think about how that resonates with the character Deja, who we watch swallow herself so much, you know, with this flag that is in the room and the whys behind that. And the idea of that, it's not even that you live under certain oppressions, but then you are asked to uphold them. Can you help me take this flag down? Can you help me put this flag up? And how that even serves as a metaphor for how you will not only perhaps put a weight on someone, but do it and then ask that person to help you with it. Yeah. If you stab me and you smile, I will still bleed. Mm-hmm. And so, and then if you ignore that I'm bleeding, which we kind of see in the last piece, mm-hmm. right? Until we have someone's death, why does it take, why do we have to get to that place, right? Even in the piece where we see the Confederate flag and
Black flag,
the character say, well, you know, I get it now. But why didn't you get it when Deja said, oh, this is actually really difficult for me? Why is that not enough? And so I'm sitting with this idea of how much one is asked to carry and how much gets erased and how much people will smile and say, I'm not part of this. I don't mean it like that, and ask you to swallow it as if they're giving you sugar when really what you're getting is poison.
Mm-hmm. You know, my mother used to say, they say they're giving you sugar, but they're really giving you shit.
Then there you have it.
You know what I'm saying? And that's, and right. that's just to put it very plainly.
Of course, Trump would not denounce white supremacy. He refuses to even say that it exists. This is one of the ways in which white supremacy operates, that we will do something up front and then pretend as if it's not happening. It's what happens when you put up a Confederate flag and then say, oh, but I don't mean it like that. And so the denial is part of the mechanism of white supremacy. Then I want to move to the piece that you talked to about Kamala Harris. Not only was she railroaded by Pence, but several times the moderator then turned to Kamala and said, I need you to stay in this time frame because we need to get to the next. Mm-hmm. This is a perfect representation of how we will watch a white man railroad a black woman and then say to her, but can you compensate for what he just did to you? And then we also watched Kamala Harris do something that we watched Deja do, that we watched in even the last scene, the character really grapple with around, you know, how am I in relationship with someone, but also having to hold myself in a way to not be assumed as something, right? And I mean, in the last scene we see, right, like this, don't be the angry black woman. We literally watched Kamala Harris try her best not to be that. Yeah. And if you watch the headlines now, what is she being called? Angry, aggressive, and all sorts of other things.
You know, particularly the black women, you know, who stood on stage today, because so often inside of our society, Malcolm X said it best, that the least valued individuals in our world are black women. We see it with Breonna Taylor. We've seen it with Sandra Bland. We've seen it with Ayanna Jones. We see it day in and day out.
I'm an angry black woman as well, and I actually think that we deserve to own that. I would be more concerned if we weren't angry. There's so much to be angry about, and so I just want to say that that is something also that lives in me. And though we live in a world that asks us to perform in a way that does not present as angry, we have every right to be angry. There is much to be angry about.
Why is this work important and why now?
Yeah. Well, when you spend every single day navigating a world that asks you to bend and mold while you are under the weight of oppressions that are not even acknowledged, what it means to be in spaces where, and I will actually just lift the words of people from your own cast and production set, actually, that this is a place where I can come and be myself unapologetically, that then this is a place where I don't have to explain myself, that this is a place where I don't have to question if I am valued, that these things are not, as Mary said at the end, leaning on the wisdom of Audre Lorde, who Audre will always give us gems, that these spaces then are not luxury, they are necessity, or literally survival.
Racism, you know, is insisting that some people are broken, but you all told the truth tonight. People aren't broken, but too often our systems are. We'll tear down those flags. The flags that don't just sit on our walls, but the ones that, you know, sit across and hang across our chests, that live in our heads. E. Biko said that the most potent weapon of the oppressor are the minds of the oppressed.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you. It is necessary. And it starts with self. These conversations are really important, and they should happen. It is just a pity that in my space, here at home in South Africa, where apartheid has served us such a slap in the face, we do not have some spaces to reflect in this way. But I don't blame anyone for that. It is I who should take that initiative. It is the theater makers like me who should take that initiative. But we are so being, is it danger? who was in that play, we are being danger. We are masking, we are protecting, we are avoiding, we are not facing the truth. We are evasive, we are lovey-dovey, and we are not doing much. We are not building anything for the next generation of the little girl in the first play, the Waragan song. We are not living, I am not living a legacy. The people that matter for the people that I should be leaving it for. My little black girls, the little black boys around the area.
Two reasons that is important for our young people to see. Because if they don't see it, you know, they remain vulnerable. They remain, you know, they remain targets of a system. And if we allow them to remain targets of that system, we are complicit. We may not load the gun, but certainly, you know, we may not pull the trigger, but we help load the guns. And so we have to acknowledge our role in it. If we remain silent and our children die, their deaths are on us. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we have to testify. We have to move. We have to, you know, get the message out to the masses. We have to declare, you know, because they are our future. And if we do not protect that future, if we do not, you know, seed ground, if we do not plant those seeds, you know, nothing will grow. And that's on us. The other reason is that they have to see themselves. It's important for them to see themselves. I'm watching this, you know, TV show. I don't watch many TV shows, especially since I've become dean. And it's like, I'm watching this TV show and it's called Lovecraft Country. And it's about, you know, this type of Afrofuturism that we can dare to kind of imagine a reality that is otherwise, that we can tell. And it's something about giving people the permission to say, yep, want to know what your imagination matters, that not only do Black lives matter, all Black lives matter, and not only do all Black lives matter, but all Black life matters, right? That Fred Moten said, and Black life is the substance of our imagination, of our reality, of our language, of those things that we can spin into existence. So not only are we declaring it to the world that we matter,
yeah,
we see it reflected back on us, the ways that we matter.
We open them and we begin. So, breathe in, breathe out.
You're broken down and tired of living life on the merry-go-round, and you can't find a fighter. But I see it in you, so we gon' walk it out. Move mountains. We gon' walk it out and move mountains. And I'll rise up, I'll rise like the day. And I rise up, I like the waves. I rise up, in spite of the ache. I rise up, and I do it 1,000 times again. Be you, be you, be you. Be you. The silence is quiet, and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe. And I know you feel like dying, but I promise we would take the world to its feet. Move mountains, bring it to its feet. For that we have each other. I will rise a thousand times again, and we'll rise up. I like the waves. We'll rise up in spite of the ache. We'll rise up, and we'll do it a thousand times again.
For the last time as us, for the last time as us, what you gonna take with you?